This is the amazing story of Gordon Stewart and the Great Danes of Send Manor.
Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out?
Who let the dogs out?
The exhibition, and especially this film, would not have been possible without Robert Heal's biography. It was first published in 2001. We thank Les and Anne Bowerman of Send Manor for donating the book to the Society. Gordon Stewart, one of seven children, was born near Epsom on May the 13th, 1885, and named William Gordon Stewart. He apparently dropped the William as he hated his nickname, Willie. His father was a tea merchant, Raynham Vivian King Stewart. His maternal grandfather, Edwin Smith, estate agent and auctioneer, was keen for the boys to go into the Navy. He supported his daughter and the children after Eleanor and Raynham's marriage ended at the turn of the century. He paid for Gordon's education at Eastbourne College, but Edwin and Gordon did not see eye to eye on his future. Gordon refused to go into the Navy and wanted to make his fortune. He got a job with the Woolsey Tool and Motor Car Company, and his first job was working for Herbert Austin. Stewart could not only see the future of cars, but also planes, and he designed the Mulliner 1 monoplane. The plane cost £450. It was received positively by aero enthusiasts, but was not commercially successful, and he quit designing planes. At the Olympia Aero Show, he met Malcolm Campbell, with whom he stayed friends. In 1911, Gordon Stewart met Arden, and Stewart and Arden was formed. Around this time, he made another key friendship with William Morris. Gordon's grandfather had said to him, "I'll bet you this dime that the motor car will never replace the horse on the streets of London." But Gordon thought otherwise. The dime that his grandfather bet him apparently stayed on his watch chain throughout his life. At the Birmingham Motor Show in 1913, Bill Morris showed his Morris Oxford with a dummy wooden motor. Gordon Stewart took a risk and ordered 400 without even a showroom. However, Stewart had funds from his grandfather's trust fund and set up his first showroom in Woodstock Street, just off Bond Street. He advertised the Morris Oxford in autocar, saying it could do 45 miles per hour, even though it had not been on the road. Once initial problems were solved, the Morris Oxford ran well, and Gordon Stewart's gamble paid off. He was a born salesman and had the car shown off in Harrods. He took part in the London to Edinburgh road trial. He won gold medals with the car and a special trophy, the Light Car Cup. Soon, Stewart and Arden moved to bigger premises in Bond Street. Later, they would circle London with modern car sales rooms in convenient locations at Croydon, Sutton, Harrow and Ilford. They were all manned by experienced technicians with the latest service equipment. In 1926, they opened a huge display and service centre at the Vale, Acton, and this was their HQ for the next 50 years. In 1934, they also moved into a prestigious central London site in Berkeley Square called Morris House. By the war, they were the largest car distributor in Britain, and Gordon Stewart was amassing a fortune to do other things. It was the success of his car dealerships that allowed Gordon to do other things. In the early 20s, when aged 36, he had bought Send Manor in Surrey. This was just after his marriage to Irene Russell. The marriage did not last, and in about 10 years they separated but were never divorced, and she lived in London in a block of flats owned by Gordon. As a boy, Gordon had a much-loved Great Dane, and when he left to make his fortune, he had had to leave the dog behind, but he never forgot his pet. It became his ambition to build the largest Great Dane kennels in the world at Send Manor. Stewart envisioned building these kennels on about 50 acres behind Send Manor. It would be an ultra-modern facility, and by careful scientific selection, it would breed a line of Great Danes not only with elegance, grace, and beauty, but with the mental qualities to prove his theory. He believed the breed had the character, stamina, and prowess to equal any other breed. He recruited Colonel Beddoes, secretary of the Great Dane Breeders Association, to help him buy the best breeding stock they could find in Europe. He planned to have his own veterinary staff, dog hospital, and kitchen, where dog food would be mixed on the premises. As there was no electricity in Senmarsh, he had his own electric generating plant installed. Reg Giles, a local carpenter, recalled that he provided employment at a time of the economic slump. Harold Giles, Reg's father, headed up a team of 25 to construct kennel runs and chicken houses. He also employed three gardeners, a butler, cook, and a maid. At its height, there were two chauffeurs, 10 kennel boys, 5 cookhouse and kitchen staff, 30 kennel maids, 2 office girls, 3 dog trainers, and 8 managers, 91 staff in all. He bought 2 Morris fire engines, one for the kennels and one he gave to Ripley.
I love my dog as much as I love you. But you may say my dog will always come through. All he asks from me is the food to give him strength. All he ever needs is love, and that he knows he'll get. So I love my dog as much as I love you. But you may say my dog will always come through.
Was recalled for Robert Heal by Phyllis Hill, a former kennel maid. He laid out new gardens, rebuilt a barn that had a tennis court on the floor which could be used for exhibitions of obedience and even dog races. The beauty of the buildings was down to the fact that they were all designed in the style of a Swiss village. They all looked like Swiss chalets, and the interiors had wooden carving and paintings of mountain scenery. The tree-lined lanes between the buildings were landscaped, and each was named. The show fields, or ranges as they were called, behind the manor house gardens, had a row of kennels with an observation office on stilts where the show manager, Robert Montgomery, could watch training progress. Mr. Huber, from Austria, was hired by Gordon Stewart to act as general manager. He travelled in Europe in the 1920s and 30s to buy Great Danes for the Send kennels. This photograph is possibly him, shown with his family and 2 Harlequin Great Danes at Dane End, Send Marsh.
My Great Dane is a really, really big doggy. I'm talking about a gigantic, enormous doggy. Sing it, everybody!
Great, 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 great Dane.
You've never seen a big old doggy. until you've seen a Great Dane. Oh my goodness, the Great Dane is a gigantic doggy.
Great, 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 a great, 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 a Great Dane.
There are big dogs, and then there's the Great Dane. Yeah, yeah, my Great Dane is a gigantic doggy. Sing it!
Great, 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 a great, 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 a Great Dane.
One step by my Great Dane is 10 steps by any other doggy. Because my Great Dane is a gigantic, gigantic doggy.
At the back of the site was the British Poultry Development and the Send Grist Mills. Gordon Stewart founded the British Poultry Development, but Send Grist Mills was an existing business that he renamed. It made animal feed, including some for the dogs and poultry. The poultry business supplied chicken and eggs, including to some London hotels, as well as providing eggs for the dogs. Later, he held poultry and pigeon shows at Send Manor, with breeders and manufacturers exhibiting. Five people prepared over 1,000 meals a day for dogs and humans. Different menus were needed for puppies, sick dogs, fat dogs, thin dogs, stud and show dogs, and any conditions requiring special food care. The horse meat vans delivered twice a week on Tuesdays and Fridays, and carcasses were stored in a Kelvinator refrigerated room that led off the kitchen. The butchers then cut up the meat, saved the bones for soup stock, and ground the meat up for the daily meals. Large slabs of biscuit were baked by Reginald French to a special recipe developed by Gordon Stewart with a group of nutritionists. There was a bakehouse, and the slabs of biscuit were broken up by machine into different sizes. Each kennel maid was responsible for her own dogs in her range section, and she collected the food from the kitchen using a trolley. The waste was disposed of in two incinerators near the rear of the property. The organisational skills from running his companies were brought to bear on this operation, and he seems to have hired good staff in. Robert Heal's opinion, nowhere in the world, then or today, has a kennel fed 1,000 meals a day, 7 days a week, year after year. In its heyday, the kennels had up to 500 dogs. It had its own veterinary hospital equipped with the latest equipment. A vet came 2 or 3 days a week from Woking and could be called at any time. There was a canine nurse and a staff of five. Stewart designed a Morris dog ambulance loaded with first aid equipment that went with the animals to shows. Rounds of the 290 kennels were undertaken daily. Once they had an outbreak of mange, probably from an imported dog, and 15 dogs were treated with railway oil. Gordon Stewart tested a vaccine for distemper in his laboratory, and by 1931, Send Kennels had no distemper and all the dogs were inoculated. Ultraviolet ray equipment was used for skin conditions and cinder tracks to harden the dogs' pads.
These four dogs are thoroughly well trained. They will only come when called by their own name, and they will not come when called by each other's name. Will you call them, please?
Yulana! Nonsense!
Nana!
Jeremy!
Kerry, hop!
Gordon Stewart started with two English Great Danes in 1921 and 10 years later had 500. many imported from the continent. He had dogs of all the Great Dane colours, fawn, brindle, black, blue, and harlequin. He wanted to prove that Great Danes could equal or better German shepherds for intelligence and prowess. They performed for royalty at Sen Manor, at agricultural and horse shows. Everything had to be first class. The staff wore crisp white jackets for shows with maroon trim on cuffs and collars and SK, for Sen Kennel, emblem on everything. There were frequent shows at Sen Manor. The Swiss barn was the focal point, called Corinda Hut. The interior was even painted by Augustus John. Even though he was a successful portrait painter, his friend Gordon Stewart persuaded him to lay aside commissions to decorate the Corinda Hut with murals of Swiss mountain scenery. Sadly, nobody seems to have any idea what became of the paintings. The building had wood carving, landscaping, and cobbled walkways. There, Mrs. Stewart entertained actors and actresses who were invited for the weekend to see exciting dog shows and races. Gracie Fields, Vivian Lee, Richard Tauber were amongst the visitors. There was dog racing in Corinda Hut, with dogs being moved forward on the spin of a wheel and betting on the outcome. Demonstrations included one dog jumping over five others. Stewart liked to impress the elite and was forever coming up with fresh ideas. Gordon Stewart first met Prince George, Duke of Kent, when he was patron of the Great Dane Club. Gordon Stewart presented his champion dog, Midas, to the Duke of Kent, but the dog stayed at Send. The Duke, his brother the future King, and the Duke of Gloucester all visited Send to watch the dog perform. They came to watch races, steeplechases, and hurdles.
These five Great Danes are all of them full champions. They were bred at the Send Kennel of Great Danes at Ripley in Surrey. This is Champion Midas of Sen, the property of His Royal Highness Prince George. This is Champion Lancelot of Sen. He is considered by experts to be the best blue Great Dane in the kingdom. This is a harlequin Great Dane. Her name is Nitza of Sen.
Stuart fostered the connection with the royal family. The Duke of York was patron of the National Safety First Association. Stewart became president of the National Safety First Association and persuaded the Duke of York to act in a picture called Alert Today, Alive Tomorrow, promoting safety first, which Gordon Stewart produced and in which Midas played a role. Great Danes, including Midas of Send, were given special training for the film. A model called Alert was presented to Gordon Stewart in 1933 for this work, and the statue subsequently came into the possession of Robert Heal, who wrote the book about Stewart. At the launch, in front of 2,000 schoolchildren, a message from Sir Malcolm Campbell was played. Midas was not the only dog to feature in a film. Michael Balcon, who had set up Gainsborough Studios, approached Gordon Stewart, and Champion Egmond of Send was the hound in The Hound of the Baskervilles. Some scenes were shot at Send Manor, but sadly no copies of the film exist. Stewart's next foray into films was a version of The Pied Piper of Hamelin. It was to be part of his children's safety crusade to commemorate the King's coronation. There was an inaugural lunch at the Savoy to promote his crusade and raise funds. Guests included Lord Nuffield and the then Minister of Transport, Lord Hawbelisha. Stewart had hoped to raise £100,000 for the campaign, but due to his enthusiasm, salesmanship and contacts, he raised that sum on the first day. Back at Sen Manor, Jack Townsend, a local rat catcher, was paid to catch live rats and deliver them to Reg Giles, Gordon Stewart's foreman. They had to build special cages and an authentic European street in Send for the village of Hamlin. In the film, the Piper offers his magical powers to the local safety council in the village. The Piper, Albert Hepburn, trained the rats to hang out of his pockets, sleeves and boots, and he led the children to safety, clutching a green torch. However, on the downside, some rats escaped, and this led to a serious outbreak of leptospirosis and the death of many dogs. 40 special Morris vans were built for the Child Safety Crusade, with Pied Piper emblems on the side and loudspeakers on top. They were dispatched across the country to spread the safety message. By 1936, Gordon Stewart seems to have appreciated that war was looming and started to dismantle his kennels, knowing he would never be able to feed the animals. His motor business, geared up to repair army vehicles and recondition engines and gearbox for the RAF and civil defence forces. They built American trucks that arrived in boxes, sometimes manufacturing their own tools to do so. According to War Department records, over 2 million machining operations were done by Stewart's company. They trained over 2,000 vehicle fitters, men and women. Stewart also served as a reservist, and in Send, the gristmill and poultry farm were expanded to feed people, not dogs. He built a laboratory called Swab House to experiment with a vaccine designed to increase milk yields of cows. The kennel ranges and the Swiss chalet were stripped out and used for storage. With the dogs gone, Gordon Stewart had many fewer visitors to Send Manor. It seems he missed the attention, and to fill the void, he turned to the theatre. Even before the war, he bought the rights to an American production called Family Portrait, and it opened at the Strand Theatre. Unfortunately for him, it was totally overshadowed by the fall of France and ticket sales dwindled. He put his energies into the war, but in 1946, Stewart's Send Manor Trust bought the lease to the Strand Theatre. It seems that Gordon Stewart was keen to promote an aspiring actress called Diana Yardley. Her real name was Diana Edmonds, and she and her sister, Molly Brown, had worked at Send Manor as kennel maids. Here she is as Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz. Needless to say, Toto was not played by a Great Dane. The exhibition included a full-page article called Gold Treasures of the Kennel Club, contributed by Val Foss. Here is an extract from it. The Send gold vases are known throughout the world of dogs. They were presented to the Kennel Club by Great Dane enthusiast Gordon Stewart, owner of the Send Dane Kennel. These days, their only outing each year is to Crufts, where they are displayed and carefully looked after 24/7. They are awarded to each of the winners of the 7 groups in the Best in Show ring. The nearest any winner actually gets to the trophy is for the photograph taken after they win the group. The trophies then go back to Clarges Street into their special glass cabinet situated prominently in the members' area of the club. 5 of them were given to the Kennel Club in 1930 by Gordon Stewart and were offered for the best of each group. Great Dane masks formed the 2 handles to each vase, and the finials for the covers represent a breed from each group: Bloodhound, Cocker Spaniel, Airedale Terrier, Pekingese, Great Dane, Bulldog and Rough Collie. In 1952, Gordon Stewart died of a massive heart attack while entertaining at Send Manor. He was buried at Send, with his ashes being placed in his mother's grave, and a huge crowd attended a memorial service at St Martin's in the Field. The Henley Group ultimately absorbed his motor business, Stewart and Arden. His estate was left to his wife, and his sisters and loyal friends and employees. While he left money to a lot of people, Gordon Stewart is largely forgotten. In his book, Robert Heal questions why he was not knighted. He offers the theory that his affairs with young actresses might have hurt him, or possibly his friendship with Prince George, Duke of Kent, who died in an air accident in 1942, but prior to that had led a fairly scandalous life by the expectations of the day. However, the author was told by several people that he was offered a knighthood in 1939, but, having craved recognition all his life, realised that he didn't need a knighthood to validate what he had achieved. Who knows? Robert Heal says by the end of his research, he felt he had come to know a man he never actually met. A dapper, kindly man, always in fashionably tailored suit and waistcoat, wearing his little pince-nez glasses, and always carrying the American dime on the end of his watch chain, the dime his grandfather Edwin had bet him so long ago.
I love my dog, baby, I love my dog.